Hi everyone, you're watching the Virtual Americas and I'm Jay Luda. So today's topic for discussion will be SIM swap frauds and the remedies that is enshrined under cyber laws as well as other laws. So what do we mean by a SIM swap and how does the fraud happen? Is it based on your phone authentication and how do these cyber criminals get access to our cell numbers or gain access to our personal sensitive data and accounts? So today, we decided to seek assistance from Mr. Dependable. We call him fondly Mr. Abhi Goel, who joins us. He's an advocate by profession. And just to give you all a brief background about our speaker for today's session, Mr. Goel specializes in due diligence, real estate laws, civil laws, and has been carrying on litigation for various multinational companies, individuals, has also adequate experience in the field of cyber laws, intellectual property laws, civil laws. He pursued his law from ICFI Dehradun. And so thank you so much, Mr. Goel, for taking time on a busy working day. And the stage is set, the floor is all yours. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Jay, for the introduction. I would further congratulate the Virtual Americas team for starting this platform. It's a great concept where we can impart our knowledge to help others and at the same time we can gain knowledge by watching it. So just without wasting the time of our viewers, let's start with this topic, that is SIM swap fraud and the remedies available to us. So before starting the concept of SIM swap, let's understand what does the term SIM stands for. So in everyday life, we all are using mobile phones and we usually say that I have this SIM card, I have that SIM card, I have a SIM card of this company. So what is actually SIM? So basically the term SIM, it stands for a subscriber identity module card. So it is basically your phone's unique identifier. It is equivalent to your phone's passport or the ID card. It's a small chip containing card that's used by the cellular providers to individually identify each of us as a subscriber. And they further allow us to communicate with their specific mobile networks, allowing us to use our mobile devices to make phone calls, send or receive text message, and take advantage of the networks being either 3G, 4G or 5G networks. So now coming to the topic of SIM swap. A SIM swap attack is a form of identity theft, or basically we can say an impersonation in which an attacker or imposter convinces a cell phone carrier into switching a victim's phone number to a new device by issuance of a new SIM card in order to gain access to bank accounts, credit card numbers, and other personal sensitive information. SIM swap attacks are these days are on the rise, increasing in popularity due to the growing dependence of the individual on the cell phone based authentication methods. Now, the first, I would just describe the steps which are being involved in a SIM swap fraud. The first step in a SIM swap attack or fraud is for the hacker or a person to target the individual by sending an email with malicious link, telephone or text message by someone posing as a legitimate institution or a person, to lure the individuals into providing sensitive data such as personally identifiable information, banking and credit card details, and passwords. Basically, we also know this method and we call this method as phishing. By way of this method, the attacker, he usually sends you the email, the text message with unknown links. And as soon as you click on those links, your information starts getting recorded on their system. And on the basis of that information, they collect the complete data. So after the attacker has collected enough information to fake the victim's identity, they will call the cell phone provider to claim that the original SIM card has been compromised or it has stopped working or maybe any other reason. And they would like the company to activate a new one in their possession to the same account using the personal data previously collected the attackers can usually provide with a fake identity card with your images and can also answer security questions without raising alarm and complete the transactions. Once this process is also completed, the attacker has access to all the victim's text message, phone calls, accounts, mails, linked to that phone number, even to the bank account numbers and the details. And since a large amount of banking, email, and social media accounts can be retrieved or reset with the mobile authentication, which is usually a OTP or a similar authentication, the SIM swap attacks. So basically what happens is, once the attacker has got all the information, he'll use that information to authenticate the your accounts, like your mail account and banking account, using the OTP method. And once he has entered into, he will just either transfer your amount or he'll pass on the information that he has collected from those accounts. Now, the question which arises here is, how do we identify that we are under a SIM swap attack? So identifying it, the foremost sign of this SIM swap attack is the discontinuation of sending or receiving the text message and the calls to a device. Once the attacker has successfully redirected a phone number, the victim's device will practically void all its communication capabilities. You will neither get a network, nor you'll get any, since you don't have a network, it's not possible to get a call, make a call, receive a call, send a message, receive a message. If such kind of thing happens, then cell phone users should immediately contact with the mobile service provider to inquire if the SIM activation has been requested by the owner or any other person. And in fact, these days, due to change in circumstances and law and the awareness to this, the mobile carriers have also started sending an email confirmation of the SIM swap, verifying this, that this was made or done by the account holder. In case the SIM has been issued by the provider company, the same may also be immediately brought to the notice of your banking partners or the institution to restrict any unauthorized transactions. Now, I would lead you to how the preventive, or how we can adopt some preventive measures to prevent ourselves from this SIM swap attack. Now, firstly, what we can do is, we can avoid relying on SMS for primary communication, as the data is not encrypted in the messages. Supposingly, you have only seen a method of obtaining an OTP. You can even go through a different method by like verifying the images or similar methods. Second is, we should keep our personal information utilized for protecting account private. We on social media and the other websites and the in fact the emails account, we should not give our personal information, which is not required or which is supposed to be kept in private, like mentioning your phone numbers, your banking account numbers, or anything like this. Then third and the most important step is verifying the types of alerts that we can set up for each account to identify the false login attempt. If you must have seen that when we log on to Gmail, if we type a wrong password, Gmail immediately sends a message on the mobile number registered as well as on the linked email account that someone has tried to log into your account. So that is a very important aspect. And the next one is, which I've already discussed, even the enabling two factors authentication for social media, credit card, and banking accounts, like in spite or even while we are using the OTP, we can also use image verification or similar methods. So now I'll just come on to the remedies that we have with us if supposingly this kind of attack or fraud has been done with us, or if we are the victim. The foremost thing is that the Reserve Bank of India, wide its circular dated 6th of July 2017 with a view to safeguard the interest of the consumers, issued a circular limiting the liability of customer in unauthorized electronic banking transaction, which is also known as zero liability. The said circular specifically provides that there should be a zero liability of the customer in the case is of contributory fraud, negligence, deficiency on part of the bank. Secondly, where there is any third party breach where the deficiency neither lies with the bank nor with the customer, but lies elsewhere in the system. And if the same is notified within 3 days to the bank, that is the utmost important part, within 3 days. So if you have notified it to the bank within a period of 3 days, then you are saved from your liability. Supposingly, if you are unable to notify it to the bank within a period of 3 days and you notify it within a period of 4 to 7 days, then the liability of the bank in such cases shall be restricted. With regard to this circular, even the High Court at Kerala, having bench at Ernakulam in the case of Tuni Enterprises versus Reserve Bank of India, has further held the applicability of the circular that has been issued by the Reserve Bank of India in SimSwap cases. Now, coming on to the second remedy, which is by way of filing a claim before the adjudicating officer duly appointed by the authority under the Information Technology Act. Section 43A of the Information Technology Act provides or punishes a body corporate that is negligent in implementing or maintaining a reasonable security practice while possessing, dealing, or handling sensitive personal data or information in a computer resource which it owns, controls, or operates, and whereby such negligence causes wrongful loss or wrongful gain to another person. So, meaning thereby, supposingly, if you have been a victim, that means that someone is using phishing, has obtained your personal information. After obtaining your personal information, he has either made your new identification card, putting his image on that, or putting anyone else's image or data on that. And after using that, he has gone to the mobile service provider and has asked that my SIM has been compromised, please issue a new SIM to me. And on the basis of that identity card or that information, the mobile service provider issues a new SIM to him. Now, the things what happens over here is, once he has used your personal data and has made a fake ID and has gone to the mobile service provider, as soon as the mobile service provider issues a new SIM to him without cross-verifying or checking with the original data and making a phone call, the mobile service provider comes at a fault. As soon as he comes at a fault, he specifically falls under the scope of Section 43A of the Information Technology Act, where a body corporate possessing or dealing or handling any sensitive personal data or information in the computer resource is compromised. Secondly, when you have received or when the accused has received the message on the mobile number that you were owning, but somehow he was able to manage or he was able to obtain the SIM, then your personal data or the sensitive data has further been compromised as and when he has utilized that message or that information for entering into any system or for hacking into your bank accounts or for transferring the funds from your bank accounts. So by way of this, the remedies that we can basically see under the Act are two. First is the circular that has been issued by the Reserve Bank of India, which gives the zero liability. And the second is under Section 43A of the Act. So this is the basic overview of the SimSwap fraud and the remedies available to us. I would request Jay to please carry on from here.
Thank you so much, Mr. Goel, for your valuable insights on a very important topic. Just a couple of quick questions. As far as the remedy is concerned, you did mention about the cyber cell. Now, are these cyber cells within the police stations or there is a separate division? If we if a person has to. And number two, if you can go ahead with the answer to the first question, then I'll ask.
See, with regard to the cyber police station, there are a few cyber, a few states have set up the different cyber station at different places, and they individually tackle and handle the cases which are committed or which are related to the cyber fraud.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. And my next question is that what about those phishing emails that we receive that demand or ask for those sensitive information with respect to our bank account details that we receive, or those fraud phone calls that are that we frequently receive on our calls? How does one avoid answering those calls?
See, the basic thing about avoiding phishing is that you don't open the emails or the messages which are from unknown sources. If you open the messages or mails that are from reliable sources, you will not get into this phishing, and no one can even take or obtain your information. So the simple answer to this question is by avoiding those things. And secondly, when someone calls you, you can bring these things to the knowledge of either the local cyber station. But each and every time in our country, even I don't think, or even in any country, it is possible for an individual to just report these things. So the basic thing would be to avoid those things that are not from reliable sources.
So avoidance is the best possible preventive measure. Thank you so much, Mr. Goel, once again for your valuable insights. Any query from anyone, feel free to write to us. We'll be more than happy to forward the same to our Americas for today's session, Mr. Ravi Goel. And thank you so much, everybody. Once again, thank you so much, Mr. Goel, in particular. And stay tuned. Next episode is on its way. Stay home, stay safe. It's goodbye for now. Thank you.
Goodbye. Thank you, Jim.